And I'm going to start by asking a question that you probably do not want to be asked. And the question is simply this. Who is the person in your life that is most difficult for you to truly forgive? Now, we don't want to be asked that. Right away, you're thinking, you know, I didn't even want to think about that person. But the fact of the matter is, as soon as I ask the question, probably for just about every one of us, a face or name comes to mind right away. Because we have that person that's difficult for us to forgive. And in fact, I'm going to ask you to not only think of it, I'm going to ask you to do something else. Everybody had in their bulletin this morning a little blank piece of paper, green piece of paper. I'm going to ask you to take that and to write either the person's name or initials on that piece of paper. If you have a pen, you could do that. If not, there's a pencil in front of you. Some of you might have more than one name. Some of you might need more pieces of paper. And hopefully not. But think about that person or those people and just think about that for a moment and say, you know, again, write down their name, write down their initials. And we have somebody that comes to mind. And I'm going to ask you to do that, and I'll explain why later on. Now, obviously, this morning we're talking about the issue of forgiveness. We're looking at the passage that Dave read with us earlier. And the fact is that when we think about it, all of us probably have someone that we have a hard time forgiving. Deep down, we know we should forgive the person. We may have even tried to forgive the person. But deep down, it's probably one of the most difficult things to truly do, to really fully forgive. But it's probably not only one of the most difficult things, it's probably one of the most important things that we need to do as well. Now, one of the things that makes it so difficult is that I think when we come to the issue of forgiveness, it's an issue that there's a lot of confusion on, a lot of misunderstanding and a lot of difficulty. We would think it's really simple, well, just to forgive. But the fact of the matter is it's really not that simple. In fact, when we think about it, I think there's not only a lot of confusion, and I can illustrate that by just asking some questions. I mean, for starters, what does forgiveness mean? You know, so when it says that we need to forgive, what does it mean to forgive a person? Do you really understand what that means? And how do we live that out? And how do we know if we've forgiven the other person? And when we think about it, you know, when we think about what forgiveness is forgiveness something that we have done? If we've wronged that, you know, if we have that person that's wronged us, and how do we know we've accomplished it? And that's a hard question. Do we leave ourselves vulnerable again? Do we trust them again? What if they keep hurting us? Another question: what does God tell us to do about forgiveness? Is it something we're called to do for everyone, or only for those who ask for forgiveness? Again, there's a lot of confusion on this. Even in this, my reading in the last couple weeks, I've read respected authors who have argued, well, God only wants us to forgive those who ask for forgiveness, and I've read other people that have argued, no, God calls us to forgive everyone. And so there are well-respected Christian authors that argue about this. What about the person if they're unrepentant? Not only if they haven't asked, but if they're unrepentant, if they continue to try to hurt us, you know, are we supposed to forgive them? Which leads us to another question. Well, if God is our example of forgiveness, well, how about God? Is God's forgiveness conditional or unconditional? How does God forgive us? Does he forgive everyone or only those who ask for forgiveness? And then we can even take this passage we're studying this morning. The passage that we're studying really comes out of that last petition in the Lord's Prayer. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Well, if we pray that, are we asking God, are we basically saying that we have to earn God's forgiveness through our actions? Are we saying, God, I understand you won't forgive me unless I've also forgiven others? And that seems to be even more the case if you look at verses 14 and 15, you know, where it says, for if you forgive those others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive you your trespasses. And it seems to be there that God is saying there's a condition, that our being forgiven is something that is conditional. But is that something that we have to earn? Because you know, those who have been around for a while know that we often refer to the first rule of interpreting the Bible, which is Scripture interprets Scripture. And you go to the very clear passages to help you understand the less clear. Well, here we're asking, what does this mean? But I can go to a very clear passage, many like this, Ephesians 2, 8, 9. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. This is not of your own doing. It is a gift of God. It's not the result of work, so that no one can boast. So clearly it's saying that the debt of sin is something that Christ pays on the cross once and for all. And we are saved by faith in what Christ has done for us alone. So a person can be extremely gracious and extremely forgiving, but if he's not put his faith in Jesus Christ, then he will never know God's forgiveness. And it's not something that we accomplish in any way by works or our effort or what we do. But then we read the passage here, to forgive as we have forgiven, and there's clearly some kind of link. So how do we understand this? You see, it's a hard question, isn't it? There's a lot of confusion. Let me even try to maybe put a lighter note on some of the illustration of this. Those who have been around for a while know that I'm a big fan of VeggieTales. And VeggieTales are kids' videos that teach, you know, scriptural principles. And part of that might be that my kids grew up with VeggieTales, and so I've watched it. But part of it is that I love the way that they take hard ideas and they simplify it for kids. But even on this issue of forgiveness, they try to teach it in a way, and you have to say, in this case, have they done it right? This is from one of the first VeggieTale videos, and they are talking about forgiveness, and the whole thing is kind of built on a spoof of the old TV show Gilligan's Island. And Larry the Cucumber is the Gilligan character, and he was responsible for wrecking the boat, and everybody's mad at him, and he's asked for forgiveness, and they won't forgive him, so he feels rejected, and he runs away. And that's where we pick up the story as the rest of the party learns about the importance of forgiveness.
I've got it!
Got what?
Our ticket out of here! We can build a giant catapult to fling us back home. Here, I'll demonstrate with this working model. You wind it up, then someone sits here, say, Bob, for example. Now, just pull this cord and...
Our house!
Ow!
Oh, dear.
Look what you've done to our house.
You bonked me on the head with a coconut.
Wow, I did not mean to do that. I am so sorry. Can you ever forgive me?
Well, I guess it was an accident, and you did say you were sorry, so I forgive you.
Thanks.
I'm really sorry about your house. I'd be glad to help you fix it if you want me to. Do you think you could forgive me?
We know you didn't mean to do it, so we'll forgive you.
Oh, thanks.
Gee, it sure does feel good to be forgiven when you make mistakes.
Yes, sir. Boy, if I said I was sorry for doing something wrong and really meant it, and people still wouldn't forgive me, I'd feel just terrible.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Well... Larry said he was sorry for smashing the boat.
And that was just an accident, too. Just like when I hit you with that coconut, or when you fell through their roof.
And we wouldn't forgive Larry at all.
So that's why he went away. He must feel terrible.
Now, again, on the whole, I love VeggieTales, and it's cute, right? But look at the story of what they're teaching about forgiveness. Well, if it was an accident, and you really didn't mean it, and you said you're sorry, then we always need to forgive. And yeah, if that's all true, we should forgive. But what about if it wasn't an accident? What about when somebody really did mean to hurt us? Or what if that person hasn't said they're sorry? You know, should we forgive then? If they did mean and they apologize, should we forgive then? Or what if they continue to hurt us? You see, it's really hard issues. Now, what I want to do this morning is that I want to look at this issue, and we're going to look at a lot of passages in the Bible. But we're going to really end coming back to the main one, this passage in Matthew 6, forgive as we have forgiven our debtors. And one of the things that we're going to see is that one of the reasons that I think there is such confusion and difficulty with this is that there are really two different manifestations of forgiveness. In a sense, two different levels. And both of them are forms of forgiveness. They're very closely related, but they are different. And the problem is that when we talk about forgiveness, we generally talk about a single word and a single concept. And what we do is we try to push these things together. And a lot of times, that's where we get a lot of the confusion of what should we do, and is forgiveness conditional and unconditional, and what if they apologize, what if they don't, and trust. And see, here's what I want you to realize, is that there are two related concepts. The first one we're going to say is the first level, level one forgiveness. It's unconditional. We're called to unconditionally forgive everyone who has wronged us. And the Bible teaches this, you know, that it says at one level we're called to forgive everyone regardless of if they meant to do it or not, regardless of whether they asked for forgiveness, regardless of even if they have stopped. That we're called to forgive those who are still sinning against us, those who are still attacking us. Look at what Jesus says in Luke chapter 6. But I say to you who hear, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who persecute you, pray for those who abuse you. You see, when we're called to do this, we're called to love those who are still acting as our enemies, to do good, to pray for God's blessing, and this requires some level of forgiveness. It means that I have to release my anger. I have to release my right, I think, to pay them back, to set justice for how they've done wrong to me. We're called to forgive, and it's unconditional, completely on their apology or their motive, or even if they have stopped doing what they've called us to do. Now, here's the key thing to understand, though, is that we're called to do it unconditionally if there has not been any repentance, confession, or anything, but we're only called to do that at a single level, at the lower level of forgiveness, forgiveness level one, in a sense. There's a second level of forgiveness that the Bible talks about as well. I'm going to call it, you know, that second level, that level two forgiveness, where we are called to forgive only those who ask for forgiveness. You see, level two is, in a sense, conditional. It's a forgiveness that can only be granted when the person has confessed their sins and asked for forgiveness. It's conditional upon what their acknowledgement. It's not for everyone who has wronged me. And see, again, there are many places in the Bible that talk about forgiveness in a conditional manner. For example, Luke chapter 17, pay attention to yourselves. If your brother sins, rebuke him. If he repents, forgive him. And if he sins against you seven times in the day and turns to you seven times saying, I repent, you must forgive him. And what's it saying? Why do we forgive? When they acknowledge their wrong and they repent. It doesn't say forgive everyone as they continue to harm you. It's no, if they repent. So we have to ask, now how do you pull these ideas together? And again, the problem is that if we've got to pull them together, but we've got to see that there's a distinction between the two. Yes, we're called to forgive everyone unconditionally at the first level of forgiveness, but the second level, level two, is only for those who have confessed and asked for forgiveness. Now, I realize that I've tried to explain this. You know, I might have you totally confused. You know, I might have you offended. It might be, and it's like, you know, what in the world are you saying? So let me try to even go a little bit further. Please stick with me. See how they're related. See, the different levels, in a sense, are revealing something about different aspects of forgiveness. Unconditional forgiveness is one that releases the person from the punishment and debt incurred by their sin, or that we feel that is incurred by their sin. See, to understand this, what we've got to realize is that anger is really little more than holding a debt against someone. It's a kind of debt. We feel someone has wronged us, and we feel that there is now a debt of justice, and we have to pay them back in some way. There's some kind of payment. So how often do you hear people talk about, you know, well, that was wrong, I deserve better, and I need to make things right? And what are we saying? You know, there is a debt, and that debt has to be paid, and until that debt has been paid, things can't be right. And so we might try to force doing that by a single act of payment through revenge, you know, that we're going to do it, or more commonly, what we try to do is we extract that payment over a long time, many times over years, by withholding our relationship with them, by the thousands of little daggers that we throw in the cold looks or the, you know, harmful statements or how we talk about the other person behind their back. So our anger is a kind of revenge. It's a way of punishing the person who has wronged us. And it's holding this debt of sin that they've wronged us in some way. We deserve better. Now, justice means that they have to pay. And so again, whether I'm going to do it right away or whether I'm going to hold on to it and continue to be able to have little payments and you know, sometime in the future I can really get it back. Now, the first level of forgiveness, recognizing I've got this debt that I'm holding against the person, and what I'm doing is that I'm releasing the debt. I'm saying, I believe that there's justice and I need to pay you back, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to release that debt. And God calls us to do that unconditionally. Again, even if the person meant to do it, even if they haven't acknowledged their sin, even if they are continuing to do it. Now, last Sunday morning, we talked a lot about forgiveness, and most of what we talked about was this kind of forgiveness, this first level of forgiveness. Now, what we have to realize now is that when we go to the second level of forgiveness, it includes everything in the first level. So it's built upon the foundation that I've released the debt, but it goes beyond it. Because it's conditional forgiveness focuses only on our releasing of our debt. Now, not only on the releasing, but it also says, now what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to restore. I'm trying to restore a relationship that was broken by the sin. You see, I'm not just trying to get past the debt, the anger. You know, I'm not only trying to let that go, I'm trying to heal the relationship that's been broken. Now, this is a hard idea, so I'm going to try to illustrate this in a physical way. And I've asked Dave Schwerer to come and help me. He asked me, now what do I need to do today? And I told him, you just have to be the personification of evil. So let's say, here we have, you know, Dave, let's say he's wronged me in some way. He's taken up some kind of sword and he's wronged me. And now when he attacks me in some way, what happens in a sense, there's something that he takes upon himself. There's two elements of how this is going to divide us. So I'm going to put this, you know, blanket on you here. Now he's wearing something that divides us. It's not only the sword, but it's the anger that he has, the hatred that he has, the selfishness, the guilt. All those things have become dividers between me and you. You see, but the problem isn't just that. The problem is that when he hurts me, you know, I likewise, it's not only that what he's done, now what happens is that I take up something of myself. I take up my anger. I'm now mad at him. I'm gonna feel like, well, I need to defend myself, so I need to take up a sword to defend myself. But in reality, it's not really defending myself. I want to hit him back. In fact, you know, I want a bigger sword than he has. Okay, now we're even better than that. Okay, so now I'm really ready to go, right? Now here's what we realize. There's now two things that divide us in that relationship. And if I feel like I'm taking this up and defending myself, I'm really not. You know what I'm doing? Is that I'm becoming like him. I'm becoming like the person that angered me. I'm taking up his weapon. I love what Paul says about this in Romans 12. He says this, do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. You know, don't take up the sword. Don't become the anger. Don't become the person that wronged you. And so he's called us to not do that, but what he's called us to do is to forgive. Now, the first level of forgiveness is totally, you know, independent of what he does. And that's my saying, I'm wearing anger. I'm burdened by my anger, my hatred, and I'm holding on to the right to hit you back. And I can unconditionally say, I'm going to lay this down. I'm going to take off my anger. I'm going to take off this burden. I'm going to unconditionally do that. It is in no way dependent upon him, on his actions. Now, what it doesn't mean is that the relationship isn't restored. It doesn't mean that I constantly move towards him, because the fact is he's still carrying his sword. It doesn't mean that I totally trust him, because the fact of the matter is I'm not going to make myself vulnerable to be hurt more. There's a wisdom of that that says it's not full restoration, because doing so is probably not healthy for me, and it's not healthy for him, because it's denying the reality of his sin that he needs to get right, not only between me and him, but him and God. But I can lay down my sword. I'm not going to attack you. I'm going to be kind. I'm going to not get revenge. But now what I am called to do is that I'm also now called to pursue reconciliation. I'm called to initiate, say, Dave, man, why do you keep attacking me? What's the issue? I'm called to talk, and if he ever gets to the point where he's willing to do that, to say, well, I realize that, and he takes off his own anger. You know, if he says, well, I'm wrong, and you confess, and he lays down his sword and he confesses, well, suddenly now he's saying, okay, I want to restore that relationship, and once he lets it down, I've got to be willing to do that. If he says, I want to heal this, I've got to be willing to accept that and to accept the embrace and accept his hand and restore it. See, if I say, well, I've done that, but I'm not willing to believe you've ever done that, see, I've never, then I'm not willing to go to level two. Do you see how that works? Does that make sense? Thank you for your help. Thanks for being evil. Love you. Dr. Evil, yeah. Now, here's the idea. We might say, well, what about justice? But he wronged me, and there has to be some justice, and who's going to set things right? Look what Paul says in Romans 12, in verse 19. It says, okay, this isn't on here. It says this, Beloved, never avenge yourself, but leave room for the wrath of God, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay. And what we've got to realize is that God calls us to say, God, I leave it up to you. Well, who's going to set it right? You know why I have a hard time forgiving? Because I believe I'm going to do a better job than God will. I think, God, I've got to hold on to this because you're not going to set it right, so I've got to hold on to it to make sure that justice is done. If I really believe that, God, I leave it up to you, it's yours to take care of, then I can lay down my sword, I can lay down my anger, and I can pray that God is going to restore it. And I'm going to accept that restoration because I believe that justice is in the hands of God. Now, what I want you to realize is that God calls us to both levels. Look at some scripture. Look at what it says. There's a Bible that the Bible's called the unconditional forgiveness. This idea of forgiving and releasing the debt of anger. Let me give you a couple of many passages. We saw this one earlier. But I say to you who hear, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who abuse you. You can't do that while you're holding on to your anger and your sword. You have to lay that down. You have to forgive. You have to release the debt unconditionally, even while that person is still your enemy, or at least while they're acting at that. Ephesians 4, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with all malice, and be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ forgave you. You know, it calls us to do it unconditionally. Now, here are some things that it means and it does not mean. It does not mean that we restore the relationship. You cannot do that on your own. You can only lay down your part of the burden. It doesn't mean we trust the other person. They still have the sword. It doesn't mean that we continue to expose ourselves to their harmful behavior. What it does mean is that we release them from any debt we feel they owe us. We turn it over to God. And instead of giving them anger and vile that we think they deserve, we treat them with kindness and compassion. We pray for God's blessing upon them. And we're open to reconciliation. See, now here's the thing, is that I'll talk to many people, they say, well, I've forgiven people, but they're not at all open to reconciliation. You know, we've even convinced that we've forgiven the person. But we're not open, and what we have to realize is that if we are not open to reconciliation, we have not ever gotten to level one forgiveness. The fact is that we're still demanding that the person has to be punished. What we've got to realize is that when we do that, we may have convinced ourselves we've forgiven them because we've let go of the right of proactively seeking judgment by taking up the sword and hammering them. But what we've done is that we've given up the right for hot justice while reserving the right for cold justice. And the cold justice may not be attacking them, but it's punishing them by withholding any possibility of relationship, of any possibility of restoration. It's saying, no, I'm never going to restore. There's always going to be a price. There's always going to be a penalty. And I'm not willing to fix that. And what we've got to see is that if we have done that, we've never forgiven the person even at the most basic level of forgiveness, that we are still holding on to our anger and our right of revenge. Now, when you look at that, it says that's unconditional. We're all called to do that, but there's also conditional forgiveness. And the Bible calls us to the second level when the person is open. We're called to always pursue it, and when they're open, we're called to get to this level of restoration. Again, Luke 17, pay attention to yourselves. If your brother sins, rebuke him. If he repents, forgive him. If he sins against you seven times a day and turns to you seven times saying, I repent, you must forgive him. Now, this is restoration forgiveness. It doesn't mean that you totally trust, but it means that you begin the process of restoring. Matthew chapter 18, it tells us that we are responsible to pursue this. It's not that I sit back and if we're there, confess, I can wait. No, it says that if we are wronged, we are called to pursue it. Look at what it says in Matthew 18. If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you've gained your brother. But even if he doesn't listen, take one or two others along with you. And so even if he doesn't listen, pursue it, continue it, try to get other people involved, try to bring healing. that we're always called to do this. We're always called to take the initiative. Again, in Romans 12:18, if possible, as far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all men. Have I done everything within my power? And is the door still open on my front? Am I still pursuing it? And what does this mean? It does not mean that we downplay the seriousness of the sin. It doesn't mean, well, we'll just forget about it. No, I know people that have done that where there's been like even an affair and, well, we'll just forget about it. And the fact is that if you downplay the significance of the affair, of the sin, what you're doing is that you're not forgiving. You have to acknowledge how harmful the sin was, because only if you truly acknowledge how harmful it is, only what is confessed can be forgiven. It doesn't mean that there are no consequences. It doesn't mean that there's an instant restoration of trust. There are times that there is sin and that you say, okay, I'm going to forgive you, but there are consequences. And there is a rebuilding of trust. And you can't say, well, you don't trust me. Yeah, you've taught me not to trust you. It takes time, but it's beginning the process of healing. Now, when we look at this, we say, okay, how do we do this? How in the world can we forgive this way? This is hard. It is. Well, what you realize is the Bible repeatedly says that we know how to forgive because we know that we've been forgiven. And God is always the example of our forgiveness. But then when we look at the whole confusion about forgiveness, how does God forgive? Ephesians 4:32 says, forgive as Christ in heaven has forgiven you. But the question is God's forgiveness conditional or unconditional? How does God forgive us? How does it work with these different views of forgiveness? Now, let's think about this. First, as it relates to our salvation. Okay, is it conditional or unconditional? There's a sense that God shows unconditional forgiveness to everyone, but not that everyone is saved. There's a sense that God withholds his justice from those who deserve it by showing this temporary forgiveness. Great example of that? Luke chapter 23, Jesus is on the cross. And while the soldiers are actively mocking him and killing him, look what he says. Forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. They deserve to be knocked down right now. They deserve straight to hell. God, forgive them what they don't know what they're doing. So there's a sense that even in salvation, God is unconditional, but we aren't saved by that. Because the whole issue of salvation is a relationship with God, that our relationship with God is broken, and it's broken by sin. And how do we have that forgiveness? It's not just he's withholding punishment, but ultimately that relationship has to be fixed, and it can only be fixed if we confess our sins and repent of our sins. And so everything that the Bible teaches about confession, about relationship with God, it's always conditional. John 1:12. To all did receive him who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Everyone is not God's child. Everyone is naturally separated from God by sin. It's only those who believe in Jesus Christ, who call upon his name, only then will we be saved. Romans 10, because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. So it's not for everyone. It's for those who accept Christ, who recognize that we are sinners, that recognize we're separated from sin, who recognize that Jesus died on the cross and we ask him to forgive us. He then forgives us and he gives us that relationship. So that's how you come to know Christ. You know him personally, first of all. Now for those who know him, once we get to know him, is it conditional or unconditional? Well, there's a sense that it's unconditional. Let's take example, 1 John 1:7. It says, if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sins. If we have a relationship with God, the blood of Jesus is constantly cleansing us from all sins. You are God's child. You cannot lose that relationship. You can't undo God's forgiveness. You can't spoil God's grace. You can't sin in a way that's greater than Jesus' work on the cross. It's unconditional. But there's also a sense that it's conditional. Because the very next verse, it says, but if you say you're not, you know, don't sin, you lie. And then look what it says. And for those who believe him, we need to confess our sins. And if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So we need to confess. And his forgiveness is dependent upon our confession. Last week, if you were here, we talked about this passage at the Lord's Supper, and Jesus talked to Peter and said, you've been washed. We've all been washed. We've all been bathed, but we get dirty feet. So we have the relationship, but we get the dirty feet of sin that God needs to wash, and we need to constantly come and confess our sins, and it's only if we confess those sins will God forgive. Now let's take that all home and end up going back to the Lord's Prayer. What does it mean then when he says, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors? What does he mean when you go to verses 14 and 15, where it says, if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive you your trespasses. What is Jesus teaching here? About us forgiving others and about knowing God's forgiveness. The key point that we've got to realize is that this passage is towards believers. This is for those who call God Father. The relationship has been established by faith in the unconditional work of Jesus Christ, that we believe in what he has done. This is not saying whether you'll be forgiven and go to heaven or not. This is saying for those who have a relationship with God as Father and how you grow in that relationship, then how does this apply? It's not saying you can lose your salvation or lose your relationship with God. What it's saying is that we can lose the enjoyment of that relationship, the intimacy, the blessings. Again, it's just like if I have teenage kids, and if one of them takes the car out, and you know, I say, well, here's the curfews at 12 o'clock, and he comes in at 2 o'clock in the morning. You know, the next morning, there's going to be some tension between me and my son. There's going to be a problem. I'm not going to disown him. I'm not going to, you know, say, well, you know, you're no longer a child. But there's a cloud over the breakfast table, and as a result of that disobedience, until we deal with that issue, that relationship is going to be strained. And there needs to be repentance, where he acknowledges what he does, and then there needs to be consequences, and then we grant forgiveness and restoration. In the same way in our journey with God, God's our Father, and this is exactly what takes place. That we go through life, and you know, we sin, and when we sin, we need to be forgiven of him. It doesn't threaten our relationship. But he says that we need to come and confess that, to be washed and to be restored. But what we have to realize is that out of all the sins that can cause problem between us and God, chief, high amongst all of them, if not chief, is that when we have undealt with issues with other people, when we're unwilling to forgive other people, God's saying, if you want to know what's really going to hurt your relationship with me as my Father, if you've got an undealt with issue with me and another you and another person, then, and you're not willing to bring that before me, then that's going to cause an issue between me and you. That's what it means, forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. What it's saying is that if we allow a division between another person and us, then God's saying, I'm not going to remove the division between me and you. That's literally what it's saying, is that there is a condition, not upon salvation, but upon our enjoyment of our relationship with God. St. Augustine said it in a very convicting way. He said, it's the terrible petition, because if we pray, forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors, and we have an unforgiving heart, we're actually asking God not to forgive us. That's scary, isn't it? And it's not that he doesn't forgive us spiritually. It's not about losing heaven. It's about losing our relationship with him, losing our enjoyment of him. It's basically saying, God, I want all your blessings. And he says, no, I'm not going to bless you until you deal with this. My friends, this is a hard issue, but it's an important issue. It starts by saying, do you have a relationship with God? Again, it all starts there. If you don't have a relationship with God, if you're still separated from God, then you won't understand all these things. So it starts by recognizing your relationship isn't what you earn. It's by acknowledging, God, I'm a sinner. I ask you to forgive me. I need your grace, and he will forgive you through Jesus Christ. For those who have that relationship with God, what we've got to realize is that God wants us to grow in it. There's incredible blessings with coming with intimacy with the Father. But what he's saying is that in the midst of all those blessings, realize that if you have undealt with issues between you and another person, that intimacy is broken. And so I started in saying, who is that person who's most difficult for you to truly forgive? You've got that person in your name. You might have that person, you know, written down on that slip right in front of you. What are you going to do with that? For some, it might be just getting to that first level of forgiveness. Okay, God, you're calling me to take off this, you know, the anger, take off the robe, lay down the sword. God, you're calling me to be able to surrender it to you. Are you willing to do it? For others, you may have thought you've done that, but you've laid down your hot anger, but you've kept the cold anger. And there's no possibility of restoration of reconciliation. And the fact of the matter is, I wanted to challenge you, you're kidding yourself. All that you've done is you've laid down the sword, but you've not laid down the burden of anger. You're still holding out punishment. Are you willing to not only lay that down, but then to pursue reconciliation? And if that person is open to reconciliation, are you willing to now embrace them and believe that God can bring healing? It doesn't mean that you just totally ignore things. Are you willing to say, God, here's the person that I've been unwilling to forgive. God, I'm willing to forgive. And I want to remind you that this is all a petition. You know what it's saying? It's not even, God's not asking you to say, God, I'm willing to forgive. You're asking, say, God, I'm willing to let you give me the ability to forgive. Because you have no more ability to forgive than you have the ability to provide your own bread. None of us do. All we do is we say, God, I see this need, and I need it like I need bread. And I ask you to give me the ability to forgive. I surrender this name to you. I ask you to take it. I ask you to give me the ability to forgive. Forgive me ultimately the ability to pursue restoration. Do a miracle that only you can do. Are you willing to do that? We're going to take a moment and close in song. And I want you in the song just to sing along, I'd say with me, but I'll say with Dave since he sings better. But as you sing and you turn your hearts toward Jesus, I want you to ask, okay, you want a relationship with him. You want to be reconciled with God. You want to be close to him. Is there an unreconciled issue with a person that's keeping you from getting right with God? And this morning, even as you sing that song and as you think of that person, you might even symbolically take that and say, you know what, I'm just going to rip it up. I'm going to tear it up. I'm going to throw it in the basket on the way out. I'm going to say, God, I surrender this to you. Today might be that day that God wants you to finally let go of that burden you've been carrying. Today might be the day that he wants to do the miracle of healing and forgiveness. Will you let him? Sing with me.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Sing it again. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace.
I hope and pray that as each one of us looks and answers the call to pursue intimacy with God, that we need it with our Father, that we recognize as we turn to him, he's telling us that the thing that might be getting in our way with between him, us and him is that thing between us and that other person. It may be symbolic this morning that you just tear that up, you rip it up, and you turn it over to God, that you're saying, God, give me the ability to forgive. It may be something that you act on. Even before you leave this morning, you say, I got to go find that person. I got to go talk to him. It may be that you just need someone to pray with and say, boy, I need to surrender this. I need help. And even after the service, Pastor Bill will be up here to talk and pray with others and seek somebody out. Seek Pastor Bill. Seek any of the staff. Seek me out this week. But let God heal you. Let him heal you in your relationship with that other person, that he would ultimately heal you in your relationship with him. The blessings are too awesome. It's too much, this blessed life. It's too awesome to lose those blessings because we're unwilling to take off that burden of anger, of revenge. We're unwilling to allow God to do the miracle of restoration between us and another person when he's already done it between us and him.